There are so many ways that we could approach a new use case on top of Foundry. How do we even get started? When I'm working with developers, I follow a bit of a homegrown solution design approach that folds together the functional requirements. That is, what's the new capability we need to deliver for our end users with the more common implementation patterns that we've seen time and time again work well across Foundry. Taken together, these two considerations help sequence and architect our use case development holistically. Now, at some point in a future video, I'd love to subject you to all my ramblings about this approach. But for this introductory series, I think we'll do something a little bit more straightforward and simply follow the data as it flows through our project. In this video, we're going to introduce the code repository environment, where we author the data transformation logic that forms the links in our pipeline. And then we'll see how the scheduler tool within Data Lineage lets us organize all of that emergent complexity into a pipeline that is reliable and performant for production use. Along the way, we'll see code snippets and example pipelines that already exist on your Foundry instance, as well as the training materials that are available to make sure you have a comprehensive introduction to all of these tools. Let's go. Let's start back in the Data Lineage tool, where we ended our last video. I'm starting with a slightly more fleshed out view of our pipeline. On your Foundry instance, you may already have a similar view saved as the Aviation Data Lineage resource, though don't worry if you don't. In the use case framing, the intent of our data pipeline is to prepare for the ontology layer. We'll get into exactly what this means in the next video, but for now, let's oversimplify and just imagine raw source system data at the start of our pipeline over here on the left, and semantic, parsimonious data coming out the other end here on the right. In between, we're writing code in three rough phases: cleanup, enrichment, and structuring. Let's zoom in and see if we can get a better understanding of what's happening inside one of these nodes. On the graph, we see that this enriched flights dataset has several inputs. If we open up the code preview tab, we can see exactly where those inputs are defined in the transform df decorator in our transform definition. This means that I can access and manipulate those inputs as data frames inside my code. To go further in the weeds, let's leave our lineage view behind and jump into the code repository resource, where this code actually lives, and step back a beat or two and define some terms we've used a bit loosely in the videos so far. At the top, we can see that we're now inside a resource called the Flight Control System repo that lives within our project folder structure. The repository itself has its own file system. On the left in the files panel, we see two root directories, one called Transforms Python and another called Transform SQL. We already got the relevant flights.py file open, but alongside we can see other transforms defined in this same repository. The code contribution experience of the code repository IDE should be familiar to most engineers who worked with Git and managed software projects in the past. You make a branch, iterate and test your changes, and make a pull request. And if these are new ideas to you, then you'll find that the specifics are well covered in our in-platform tutorials, webinars, and documentation, and that the core concepts are taken from tried and true software development best practices. Looking at our specific example code, we've got our inputs and outputs defined, and then a compute function where we've written a bunch of PySpark to join together our inputs and produce a final output data frame. Francisco will do a thorough code review of this in a later video, so let's avert our eyes for a moment and instead follow the output link to jump from the code into the dataset resource itself. So now we have the concepts to understand our pipeline one level deeper. Each dataset wraps together a set of files in the underlying distributed file system. Most commonly, these represent a data frame and its associated schema. The job spec defines everything we need to create this dataset. You rarely need to look at the job spec itself, but if you do, you'll see the references to input datasets by their unique resource identifier and the computation parameters that point to a specific file within our transformation logic. This is everything we need to give to the build system so that it can actually grab the relevant data, execute the code, and produce our output dataset. And then we have the code itself, which determines what actually happens inside our job, which we call a transform. And that's what we just saw defined within our code repository. And if we were to make a visual representation of that whole arrangement, you'd have, well, the lineage view that we started this whole thing off with. Now that we understand how each individual dataset derives from its transformation logic, let's see how we can manage the emergent complexity of our entire pipeline. We can dip our toes into this by looking at the idea of a schedule. For the reference project, we have one master schedule configured, and when we open it up, our coloring changes to reflect the schedule configuration. This is a pretty typical push mode schedule. I've got a set of target datasets to build at the end of my pipeline, and a set of trigger datasets to monitor for new data. In this case, my schedule will run whenever all of these trigger datasets have received new data. And when that schedule is triggered, and I can also just do it manually, which is handy for testing and iteration during development, I leave it up to the Foundry build system to figure out the intervening datasets that need to update, along with the right order to update them in. And each time the schedule runs, the details about performance and the version of code and data used are recorded in the schedule metrics. Now, the pipelines and best practices section in the code repository's concepts documentation goes into much more detail on how you should structure your pipeline and how best to configure your schedules for production execution. Make sure to check those resources out as you dive into your next project. While this pipeline is just the starting point of our larger use case project, data transformation alone can be a topic of potentially bottomless complexity. As data scale, performance requirements, or logical complexity grow, you'll benefit from understanding more advanced topics in data engineering. Stay tuned and subscribe to this channel to explore our other videos in this area, like how to encapsulate your pipeline logic into reusable libraries, or how branching in Foundry can isolate not just your code, but also your data, or how you can build incremental pipelines that save time and resources by only processing what's new. If you stick around, you'll also see my colleague Francisco give my less than stellar PySpark in the reference project a thorough code review. And you'll also get the next video in this series, where we'll look at the Foundry concept of ontology and see how it serves as a structural layer between our data pipeline and our application development. See you there.